My name is Anand, Prabhu. For the major part of my life, I lived in Saudi. My father used to work for an American company called Aramco. And typically, I believe, if I'm not incorrect, we lived about 12, 13 years of my life there. Till my father one day was packed back because he was caught with alcohol. The money had to be left behind in Saudi. So whatever he made, of course, stayed back. And he was sent backpacking. And the funny thing, of course, having worked and lived there for about 13 years, he came back with nothing, actually. He got into printing, took a place on rent, had a printing press. I guess in our lives, although we were a Catholic family, Jesus probably was really not first place in our lives, although we used to go to Mass as a family and do the things that most Catholic families do without even realizing that what they were doing. My father, at that point in time, when I was studying in college, he wanted me to get into business along with him. I couldn't see myself working with my uncle, Mickey, who was younger than my dad, because we really couldn't see eye to eye, you know, on many issues, although it wasn't business, but just, you know, principles and stuff like that. And I told my father, I said, you know, that I probably want to go back to Saudi and or somewhere else, but not work with you because of the relationship that I had with my uncle. And he said to me, you know, since Uncle Mickey has been around in business for a long time, so I might as well, you know, keep with him, and you might want to make a life for yourself. And I thought that kind of strange because I thought my father loved me more than his brother. But I guess he did. It's just business probably came first before love, you know, at that point in time. So I went out to Saudi and I kind of lived there for a couple of years with the intent that I would probably work, you know, hard and, you know, make a life for myself. And I was now more committed than ever because there was no going back. I was working for a company called Flora Arabia, which is an American company. One fine day, the salary that I was making from the company was, in my mind, I was young, 19 years of age, was not enough. It was enough for everybody else, but not for me. Tom Dempsey was my immediate boss. I said to him that, you know, Tom, I have a plan, and that plan was to keep in every single porter cabin that housed people that were working for Floor and the other ancillary companies, a fridge that stocked Pepsi's and Moosey's and Dr. Pepper, you know, Sprite, all that stuff. So he said, what is the plan? I said, you know what? In a place called Al-Hasa, which is like an hour away from Shedgam where I lived in the camp, these things were available for 80 halalas, which is not even 1 rial. Okay? Typically, the price in the camp, in the shops, was 2 rials. But if I had it served in the porter cabin, where people didn't really have to leave the porter cabin to go into the shop to buy at the same price, we'd probably still make some money. He's a prime face man, it looks good. So let's do it. So we went across to this thing in a big pickup truck, picked up like 10 fridges. You won't believe it. We came back in the evening to see what our collection was. And we were amazed because every single Pepsi, every single cold drink that we kept over there, it was all over. And we were kind of busy counting money till 2 o'clock in the morning. It was incredible because the kind of money that I made was pretty much equal to the salary that I was making a month. So when Tom saw that, he said, man, you know, you're really cut out for business. And he so wanted me to leave Saudi when he left eventually and get into school, like an MBA program, and he and me would, you know, get into business together. That was a long-term plan. It sounded fine because he said I would take care of the expenses and all this stuff. I said, great, if somebody's going to be sponsoring my education, question is why should I go into my wallet and, you know, take my own money? Till came a time when my father and my father's brother had a falling out in business. So he made a trip to Saudi saying that now he needed me. You know, and as plainly as he put it, you know, there was no need for me to, you know, because you had a falling out in business and this happens all the time. So why do you really need somebody like me who didn't have skill sets to run a business or support my father in a business such as the one he was running? So I clearly couldn't see the point of me leaving what I had there and joining my dad. Tried to convince me for 2 days that he was there in Saudi, and he went back. Probably disillusioned, but I really couldn't care very much because I thought my father was a man that rose from where he came from, which was a farmer, to where he had reached, which was absolutely awesome. So why would he need somebody like me, who was just 19, to swing out of a loss making business? Didn't make any sense to me. But I was, you know, perturbed and I was concerned because he was my dad, you know, and you don't want to see your dad, you know, unhappy, or your mom unhappy. Then that evening, I met up with Tom Dempsey and I said, Tom, I said, this is what my dad wants to do. We're kind of just talking shop. He says, don't you ever think of it. And he said a few things that were not nice, and I don't even want to probably share it in front of the camera, but the moment he said that, that kind of set me ticking. So when he said what he said about my dad, I said to myself, you know, that this was not the man that I wanted sponsoring me, or that I wanted to sort of, you know, have any relationship with that went on to being more deeper. So I said, Tom, you know what? I'm just thinking about this, and I think I will leave Saudi tomorrow, just tomorrow. And then I had to go and join my dad in business. As the Lord wanted it, I got my passport the next day and I flew off to Bombay. Then I left, came back, rang the doorbell, and it was like 6:30, 7 o'clock in the evening. Opened the door, and there was my dad. And he was kind of completely, you know, amazed to see me, because here was this guy who said no, and 2 days later I was there. And the first thing I remember that he said to me, he says, son, you're back. So it's like literally the prodigal son coming back to, you know, his father. And before I left, we had a good relationship, but not really great. My father never thought the world of me in terms of, you know, that this son would do well in life or reasonably well in life. So that was always there, and that was always there in my head. So when he said this to me, I felt in my heart that he loved me to start with. And that was great. You know, it felt like all those 19 years of not really having said, you know, as much as he could have said as a dad, he said in just one sentence. We went to the office the next morning, beautiful office, you know, 84 Jolly Maker Chambers number 2, Nariman Point, every window you saw the sea. But then business, of course, was in the balance. There was no business, there was business, but a lot of loans and loans had to be taken, of course, to pay back by uncle.
My name is Jean Prabhu, and I'm from Mumbai. Bombay is a great city. There's a lot of vibrancy in it.
Jean's father, Flavian, and my dad were good friends. My dad went around introducing me to all of the staff. Pretty girls we have at the office, but I guess for me, she was the prettiest. And the moment I saw her, I knew in my spirit, I'm saying that in my spirit now, but in, you know, going back, I knew that was the girl for me. A month later, we went on our first date. And we probably never looked back. We dated for a couple of years, then she went off to the States, much against my better wishes and, you know, understanding. So I said to myself, you know, once she's gone, I know a lot of people, of course, that have left India for the States and never come back, you know. And what were the chances of her coming back to be with me when there were so many good-looking men, you know, in America? And I said to myself, you know, I guess she won't come back. But then I wrote her a letter. Every single letter, every single day, as God was my witness, every single day, it didn't matter what time of the night I slept, but I wrote a letter and posted it. And then she came back a couple of years later, and we got married, which is really, really awesome. And we've been living in this house ever since, which is like 31 years. Proud to father and mother, three kids. My father was, he believed in Jesus, but never really went to Mass every Sunday. And we ran our business, my dad, myself, my brother Prem, for a few years. And then we had a falling out. The falling out that we had in business was not conducive, you know, to family and the well-being of the family. My father one fine day decided, of course, to go with my mother to Divine. We never really, you know, knew of his plans. But he did that 5-day retreat at Divine and came back totally refreshed. 5 days later, when they came back, they called us up, and I recall that I was having a drink in my bedroom, pretty upset with myself and with what was happening in life. Even at some point in time, was even contemplating jumping from the 15th floor, which I am not a suicidal person, but I guess at that point in time and what I was going through, you know, that happened to me. Then my dad and mom called me that evening and called the entire family to apologize. So we sat that evening after they came back in their house, all on the ground, I remember, in a bedroom, not even on sofa sets. And they told us of their experience, which was wonderful, really. And that was the side of my dad that I hadn't seen for a long time, from the point of view that he never spoke about Jesus. He may have felt him in his heart, but never spoke. And one thing, of course, they told us that it was important, of course, that we did a retreat. at some point in our lives. They weren't forcing us to do it now or then or tomorrow, but they said at some point in time, they let us know how their lives were impacted and that we should sort of make it, you know, as a family together some point in time. And it really didn't appeal to me because, you know, I was like a Sunday going Catholic. I thought I was okay. I didn't really need to do this. And my father and my mother eventually, of course, followed that up with another retreat that they organized. And again, it was so unbecoming of my dad, of course, to organize a retreat for somebody that never went to church, to organize a whole team of people. There were a lot of people that came in from a certain part of India. Unfortunately for the family and for the church, my father passed away before the people could come down, you know, from the retreat center. And we were in two minds whether to go ahead with the retreat happening or just, you know, close, I mean, you know, cancel it altogether.
I felt the Lord was calling me to make a retreat, but I didn't know what the whole experience was. And I had three small children, and I could not really think of taking time off and going for a retreat.
Frankly, I didn't really want to go because I didn't think that I needed to be saved. I didn't think I needed any Jesus any more than I already or probably had him in my life. And somebody, of course, mentioned to me that your father's no longer there, but he would have loved to have seen you attend. And that kind of, you know, upset me as well. I said, you know, thinking, I said, why would he do that? Unless, until, of course, I am, you know, a sinful person, this, that, and the other. Not knowing that I am a sinful person. But you always think of yourself as somebody that you're not, you know. And Jean, of course, motivated me. And she says, you know, it was your dad's wish and desire, of course, we make this retreat, and I think we should. Because what will really happen is only something good will come out of it, you know, nothing bad.
So we attended the retreat. It was a wonderful experience. We didn't know, it was our first retreat. We didn't know about praise and worship, about the dogs, about the infilling. We didn't have a clue. I was asthmatic for the most of my life at that time, since the age of 5. And it was an allergic kind of asthma whenever I ate certain things like coffee or drank coffee or had an orange or had an egg, I would get the wheeze and, you know, it would go further into asthma. So during the retreat, in one of the breaks, I had a nice hot cup of coffee and I didn't get the wheeze, which showed, you know, that I was healed. And
when she says it was a faith, she's faithful even more than I am. And when she was delivered of asthma, like she claims to have been delivered on the first or the second day of the retreat or the third day, I'm not too sure when, and she'd mentioned this to me, I was kind of pretty dumbstruck because, you know, how do you say by drinking one cup of coffee that you'd be delivered of asthma? But that was her faith, and her faith stood strong because it's been, you know, 20 years, maybe even more, you know, that she's not got a single wheeze. Forget asthma. Asthma is like, you know, a huge thing, but she's even not suffered a wheeze, and which I think was great because it helped my faith increase.
After that experience, I felt that I should do another one and that I should share it with others. So we went along with a whole group of our parishioners to Divine Retreat Center, and that was a wonderful experience. And before the retreat, okay, I felt I was a good Catholic. But after the retreat, I started turning to him in so many areas of my life.
With this split in business, there was a lot of unforgiveness in our lives. And, you know, that we came to terms with, that we had to forgive. And that was the Lord's message for us, that, you know, we have to forgive, we have to break all barriers and keep the communication lines with the rest of the family open. That was the message for him, from the Lord to us, I feel. And that really helped us.
People's names were being called out of being delivered of, you know, different ailments and, you know, stuff like that. And I recall very vividly that he called out all Catholic names, you know, or all English sounding names. Not a single non-Catholic sounding name that was ever announced. I said, every single name that you've called out is an English name. I said, do you know a guy called Anand? And you won't believe this, that as I said that, and I finished saying what I said, Father Augustine announced my name. For me, that was like the start of knowing that Jesus loves me and he is there with me and will see me through my good times and my bad times. And he was there at that point in time. And the message that Father Augustine, through the Lord, had for me was that he had carved me in the palm of his hand and that I had no reason to worry.
And how the Lord would speak to me was that if I was, when I was confused, I would pray and he would leave one window open. Whether it was to consult him about my children's education or whether it was to consult him about my investments, there would just be that one window that would be open, all the other doors would be closed. And in fact, even when my daughter, my eldest daughter, was going to get married, she was getting proposals. She saw a photograph of this boy and she fell for him, and one thing led to the next. So when she decided that she liked this boy and she would like to get married, I said, why don't you just go to Kerala to Divine Retreat Center and make a retreat and see whether it's the Lord's will for you. She went to retreat center. She said, I'll go. She made a retreat. She met Father Augustine and she counseled with him, with Father Matthew. And then they prayed with her and they said, fine, you can go ahead to marry this boy. And she married him. And wow, that was really the right decision of her life. And praise and thank God for this boy. And then my second daughter wanted to do her MBA. So I told her, I said, she did her GMAT, she was not happy with the score. Then I told her, I said, see, you've done your GMAT, you're not happy with the score. And now you're about 24, 25 years old. I think maybe you should get married. Because she was getting some nice proposals. So she said, no, I want to do my MBA. I said, okay, go to Kerala and do a retreat. So she went all alone, did a retreat. She met Father Michael, I think, there. He prayed with her and he said, you do your MBA. So she said, okay, but my mom says I should get married. What should I tell my mom? So he says, well, as I can see it, your MBA will work around your marriage. So she came back, she got admission into pretty much the best MBA college in the country. And she got a fantastic job. She came back to Bombay and the MBA worked around her job and it's worked around her marriage. God's mercies and His wisdom is amazing in our lives.
After we made the retreat, we had business that came through for us from every nook and corner pretty much. So the first 2 or 3 years of the retreat that we made, we had a whole bunch of orders that came through. We worked hard, but a lot of people work hard. And he was blessing us every single day with orders and business. I remember one time when Jean's sister from the States and her brother-in-law were in town with their 3 kids, and we had our own 3 kids here with a maid. And there was kind of pandemonium, and because we were going out that evening for dinner, everything was all set to meet, to leave here at about 9:30. And I suddenly heard in the silence of my mind, as it were, the Lord asking me, where is my time? And that was one day that we'd forgotten, visiting Jesus in the Blessed Sacrament. And the first thing that I asked the Lord, with all the pandemonium that was happening inside the house with kids, screaming and bawling, I said, Lord, is that you? And prompt came the reply, as immediately as I'm saying this to you, yes, I am. And I said to myself, this can't be true. I'm a sinner. And why would the Lord be talking to me? He should be talking to people holier than me. Little realizing that the Lord loves me as dearly as He did then and even now. And I said, Lord, if this is you, then I need to sort of, leave this place and go and pray. I went to St. Andrew's Church Chapel. I sat down there for an hour. And for the first 45 minutes, I just wept like a baby because I don't know why. I know why. It's just that the Lord's presence was all over me. I could literally feel Him within me, and that, the love that He had for me. For the next 15 minutes after that, I heard music. There was nobody else in the chapel except me. And this was like not music that you hear in praise and worship, of course, which is again divine music. But this was music with no organ, with no guitar, something that was not there within the periphery of the chapel, but was there in my mind. And I felt it was incredible. It's been a blessing now that Jean and I are allowed, of course, to take friends of ours to Divine every single year. And we've been attending their international youth and couple conferences every year. And at the last one that we were there, this July, I believe, Maria came across to us one day and talked to Jean and me. She says, you have to testify. The day came, we got up in the morning, attending the outreach. And morning came, breakfast time came, and I kind of, although we normally have a very sumptuous breakfast even at Kota, the desire, of course, to eat was not there because I had kind of butterflies in my stomach. And I said, maybe I'll skip breakfast. I'll fast and pray, and you know, maybe the Lord will give me, you know, a sense of doing this. Breakfast came. I didn't have breakfast. Lunch, I kind of just picked on a bit of rice and vegetables and all the stuff. But I was, and I left my stomach hungry. Dinner time came, and I said, you know, man, I can't have dinner because I was still not very comfortable with, you know, having to, you know, do what I had to do. And at about 9:30, when Maria met up with me, and she says, Anand, are you all ready? I said, no, Maria. I said, is there any way that we can sort of, you know, dispense with this? I'll be very happy. She says, no, Maria, we're praying for you. And I was on stage. She gave me the mic in my hand. And as she did that, as God is my witness, the fear that had sort of engripped me all since the morning or the previous night, all the way through, was suddenly gone, and I had this yearning now of taking the mic in my hand and addressing the crowd. And it was really awesome because fear is something that kind of bogs you down so seriously that you're not able to sort of do what God is calling you to do. And I think that was a great opportune moment for me, of course, to, you know, sort of let the people know, or God's people know, as to what God had done in my life. For the longest time in St. Anne's, we didn't have a chapel. And we, Jean and myself, used to go to chapels that were built at St. Teresa's, at St. Peter's, at St. Andrew's. One fine day, Jean was at a prayer service, or at a core team meeting, as it were, of the St. Anne's prayer group. And I was, that one time, you know, sitting alone at St. Teresa's praying. Wasn't praying for the chapel, really. And suddenly, out of the blue, the Lord shows me in a vision this room that was locked, dark, dusty, with the usual mirrors, you know, with cobwebs all over the place. And I'm asking the Lord, I said, no, where is it that you've taken me? And the Lord says, this is going to be a new chapel. So I said, Lord, but where is this place? You know, where is this chapel going to be? He says, this is exactly behind where the sacristy sits down. And I hadn't seen that place for the longest period ever, you know, and that place has been closed for maybe 15, 20, 25 years. I don't really remember how long. I collected my Bible, went across to the church, and typically 4, 5, 4, 10 is when Father John, who was the then parish priest, of course, opens doors to visitors. And I said, Father, I said, I found the chapel. So the guy looks at me, you know, totally, son, and there is no place. We've discussed this before. I said, Father, if you permit me, just please leave your office and I'll take you to the place where the Lord has shown me. I haven't seen it. It's a locked door. We just have to open it. So he comes there where I took him, and there was this locked door still locked. And I said, Father, if you could just have this door open. And as the Lord had shown me in the vision, the room that was at the chapel, exactly the same. Nothing had changed. He looked at the place and he said, Anand, this is awesome. He says, where did you find this? I said, Father, when I was praying at, you know, St. Teresa's Church. He's looking at me a little, you know, really? I mean, God really revealed this to you? I said, yes, Father. And this next thing was, when can we start the work? Chapel was built a month down the line, and our people at St. Anne's are blessed. I know we are, Jean and myself, my kids are. And we go there every single day, which is absolutely such a blessing. Nothing is as important as the time that we spend. For me, that is precious time. You know, he can take anything away from me, but that is a time with him that I pray that he will give me not only that hour and 10 that we now spend, but more with each passing time. And for us, it's not only been a blessing of the time, even our kids in the years gone by, when they were studying for their, you know, college exams, university exams, and what have you, no matter how long the exams were, it could be 2 hours, 3 hour papers, 4 hour papers, we'd sit down there for 3 and 4 hours, just thanking the Lord for the gift of kids, thanking the Lord for the gift of education, thanking the Lord for the gift of being able to spend that time. Because even in business, you know, to typically take away 3 and 4 hours of your time to give it to the Lord, you'd never have God or the Lord indebted to you. He will always give you, you know, exceedingly, abundantly, more than you, you know, choose and desire. And that, when I came back, the first thing that I thought was, you know, I'm coming back to my dad, my mom, I'm going to help them, support them, and bring them out of the, you know, mess that, you know, has happened here in business. And this was like a couple of years ago when I was sitting and just, I don't know whether I was praying or just thinking. And I suddenly saw Jean. And the Lord was pointing my direction towards her with the realization that those year, the year, the time that I came back to spend time with my dad, he didn't shortchange me. Not only did he give me a business, of course, that I could call my own along with him, but he gave me Jean. And for the reason that Jean was working with my dad on a holiday job for that 1 month only when I came back. And my hands, my hair standing as well. He said, all of the three kids love Jesus. And I think if I, as a dad, she's done great things as a mom, but if I, as a dad, can say that I've done something good in my life, and that is probably to give them Jesus, you know. And I may not have been a great father, you know, in many ways than one, but this is something, of course, that Jean and me, collectively or individually, of course, emphasize that the need for prayer was important. The need to make Jesus the first person in your life, person meaning God in your life, was also important. And if we had Him in our corner, you know, there'd be ups and downs in life, but He would pick you up each single time that you fail. He's done that with us, and we know how well. And from experience, we said to them that this is what you need to do. As they embark on their lives now with their own soulmates, we feel blessed because God's typically, of course, you know, carried them through, given them great spouses, you know, which I think is so important, of course, to carry a generation, you know, that lives out of faith.
He's really truly the God of the impossible and the God of love.
For people that are watching this program also, my request to all of you is that stay focused on Jesus, because He's the only focus that you need to have in life. You know, everything else is so ancillary and so not important. They're important, of course, from a worldly point of view, but with Him, but staying focused with Him, you know, everything else, you know, comes together for His greater plan and glory. He brought us to Him at the time that He found it was perfect. Although I say, in retrospect, if I had only known Jesus before 38, it would have been such a wonderful experience. But then again, His timing is always perfect. And I thank Him again and ask Him for His hand of protection on my family and immediate as well as extended on my friends. And thank you, Lord Jesus, for everything that You've done for me in my life. Amen.